Hello, folks, and welcome to another installation of our Coady Connect webinar series. I am Wendy Craiglin-Gauthier, and I am the moderator of our webinar today and also the manager of networks and ongoing learning. For our folks who are joining us offline, off the recorded version, you will find all of our Coady Connect webinars on YouTube. So today, is going to talk about universal design for learning, connecting accessibility and adult learning. So a little bit about who I am. I'm gonna turn my webcam on a little bit here. Okay, there we go. So my name is Wendy Craiglin-Gauthier, as I mentioned, and the current manager of networks and ongoing learning here at the Coady Institute. My role is to work with our teaching staff and our students as they navigate their space in an online context. In our classroom processes, we're starting to use more digital content and provide more digital resources for our learners so that it is available when they our campus. And we're also making a foray into the online world, and we're using a learning management system called Moodle in order to deliver our content. Also online is our Collaborate, the platform that we're using here. It's designed as an online classroom. Now, what that all means for our participants, for our instructors, for our facilitators, is that we have to start thinking a little bit as well about how we're using the tools of teaching in these new digital spaces. So what I'm going to talk today is all about UDL, Universal Design for Learning, which is an approach to creating the most equitable learning spaces for all who are participating. And what I'm also doing is making a very conscious between the idea of UDL and to Malcolm Knowles' theory of adult learning. So if we think of adult learning, we think about self-direction, knowledge generation, the opportunity to have life experiences come into the conversations as we are learning. So what I'm hoping for in the next hour is that you get a sense of what it means to be an accessible educator, what it means to provide accessible learning opportunities to your students. Now, these ideas will translate also into a face-to-face classroom, because we're looking more about that 30,000 feet about accessible learning. And I'm hoping that you'll come away with some strategies and new ways to think about how you're providing information. So I'm going to turn off my webcam, and I'm just going to start the actual presentation. So when you think about being in an online space, the way the 21st century has evolved so quickly, we are faced with so many challenges and so many opportunities because of the new digital landscape of our classrooms and how we gain information and how we share information. And when we think about information and communication technologies, or ICTs, what we're also thinking about as well is what open education resources are there. So what is being shared for the benefit of the greater good without having it? And you'll notice that a lot of our Coady publications, our documents, are open source, because we want to very specifically and intentionally invite people to share learning and to share knowledge. So we're able to do that based on the kinds of funding arrangements with our publications. But when we think about open education resources, we also have to think about, you know, how that changes who our audience is. So no longer we're tied to a physical classroom in a geographical location. We're able to very nimbly address the needs in the classroom that we've designed in space, but also be very intuitive and to tailor our content to have a broader access as well. So that's a wonderful opportunity that we have because of the internet. One of the things that, from my perspective as an adult educator and as a person who believes very strongly in universal design processes and social justice, is to make sure that the learners stay in the driver's seat of how we are designing those educational opportunities. One of the pitfalls that I see in my work with educators in terms of pedagogy and in terms of integrating technology is we sometimes will tend to have what technology is available to drive that learning. And that, I have two quotations on the whiteboard here. Michael Fullan is quoted as saying that learning is the driver and technology is the accelerator of that learning. But then George Koros came back and said, well, wait a minute. We still need to keep our learners front and center and have them drive the learning and then identify what technology is the most appropriate in order to achieve our educational goals. So I think that's very worthy of reflection. Now, when you think of transformational learning, in an online space, Garrison and Kanuka are Canadian researchers who have been looking at the online space and adult learning for years now. And they really look at the idea of to be able to provide transformation, and that's one of the key tenets of adult ed, is when you have an opportunity in that learning that stems from the ability of your online learners to be both together and apart. So to be connected to a community of learners without being bound by space or the situation, that's where that amazing opportunity for transformation, to be able to gain that perspective, the new ideas from wherever that learner may be from in the globe, rather than ones who are able to be just in one physical location. Now, the image that is on the screen right now is of concentric circles of individuals standing, talking in a community circle. And there are six of these individual circles, but the drawings connect them all together to the center. And that's, I think, is very important to visualize that learners aren't alone in their own spaces. They are bringing the shared context and the shared meaning and shared understanding from wherever they are, and it loops back into the collective learning space itself. So when we think about adult learning theories, we think about adult learning as being self-directed, as being rooted in that knowledge and experiences, and being goal-oriented, being relevant to where the learner is in their context, what they need to know, which leads us to the practicality of it. We have the sake of learning for knowledge, but also the sake of learning for practical skills. And also with adult learning, it's the idea of collaborative. And when we look at learning preferences, some learners may prefer to learn in isolation, but with the theory of adult learning, one aspect is to be collaborative as well, because it's about that perspective sharing and perspective building. So to take it out a step further then, what we need to think about in terms of engaging our learners is to put in a lens of inclusivity. So when we think about our adult learners who have left school early, whether that be because of access to education, whether that be because of life circumstances, or whatever that reason for disengaging from school, what it does is it creates so many of our population automatically are in a disadvantage, because they have not had the opportunity to learn amongst their peer group, their peer age group. And what we do know is that people who have are adult learners in our adult literacy classrooms in Canada, that disengagement and that inequity is disproportionately larger for students who have lived in poverty, for students with disabilities, for students from ethnic minorities, and from our Indigenous and First Nations communities. So when we think about inclusive education and designing learning for all, we really need to keep a little part of our mind to be very specifically focused on the marginalized of the marginalized. So now from an educator's point of view, when we think about andragogy, so when andragogy is the study and practice of adult learning, you'll notice in my presentation today, I use the word pedagogy. The reason why is because I choose my definition to mean teaching practices, and my philosophical background is to have the learner always in the center. So I just happen to use the word pedagogy. But when you think about what Knowles said about andragogy, and adults need to be involved in the planning and the learning of the planning and the evaluation of all their instruction. They also need to have an opportunity to input their experiences, including the mistakes that may have been made in the past and in the current moment, because it helps to form the basis of those learning activities. So you're trying to create a space in which the learner feels safe enough to reach out to their peers, to their instructor, to say, hey, I don't understand what's happening here. I need more assistance in this, or you know, perhaps this is how I have learned from doing it the wrong way. And what we also find is that adults are most interested in learning subjects that have immediate relevance to their work, to their lives, to their personal interests. And oftentimes our learning is designed based on trying to solve problems. So often when we're with our Coady participants in our classrooms, we talk about action research, where you're seizing an opportunity to follow a research goal to improve a situation within a community. Well, when you loop in the idea of adult learning to be able to solve that problem, you've got a purpose. So when we're talking about digital spaces with online learning, what does community look like when we can't physically see the people who are in that space with us? When we define community as not the physical people, but how we actually connect with each other. So I like this definition from Rovea, who said that elements of community include mutual independence among members. A member of a community has a sense of belonging. It's a connectedness. There's a spirit, trust, interactivity. There's common expectations, shared values and goals, and overlapping histories amongst others. You'll notice that it doesn't say anything about being in a physical space or in a specific time. And that's important to remember when we're thinking about developing community for learning in our digital spaces, that we're not bound by that geography. And it's really important, though, to really think about who's in our classrooms, though. How do we interact with those individuals in the online space? And how do we share that space? We're so used to walking. How does that sense of learning identity come into our online spaces? So when a educator is designing that online space, what they're doing is really looking at ways to build on the student's current knowledge. And that's what we call constructivist education, constructivist pedagogical activities. We're trying to maximize the student's engagement and motivation, and making sure that they feel a sense of connection with the instructors and their classmates. So what does that look like? What we're trying to do then is to create opportunities where students are encouraged to share their own experiences, and learning activities are specifically designed for students to be able to apply their knowledge and understanding from their own context and interactions with the peers. Now, in an online space, what that looks like is in the discussion forums, where you're inviting the participants to be able to provide information, to share as much information about themselves, their context, as they are able to. And to purposely create that introductory discussion forum where people take a moment to say hello to each other, to say where they're coming from, what their context is. Maybe there are connections from a physical presence, from other programs, from other locations, other organizations. And when we're talking about assignments, we're talking about assignments that enable us to apply learning from our own organizations, apply learning from our own life experiences, and to make the connections with the outer learning outcomes. So the outer areas of what is the subject matter we need to do, but how do we critically apply that subject matter? So having choice in assignments. So not all 20 people in the classroom have to do the exact same assignment. Perhaps there's a choice between creating a tool, between providing a research report, between conducting interviews. Again, what you're doing is you're maximizing on students' engagement and motivation as well. So you're wanting them to be able to find out where they most strongly engage in that curriculum. You know, and when you think about it, you know, we've been talking about the Kolb's experiential learning cycle for 30 years, 35 years. It's 1984. It's been around a long time. But what's very interesting, though, is that this model of experiential learning applies still today in the 21st century. What it does is it really values the concrete experience, the reflective observation, the active experimentation, abstract conceptualization. All of that can happen in an online space. So when you think about the concrete experience aspect, so you're engaging in an activity or an experience. So in that case, it could be the learner is either doing a discussion forum or they're going out and they're mapping their community, they're looking at applying a tool, and they've put themselves into that context. They've looked at the assignment and they're concretely mapping what they are doing against those assignment objectives. But where it gets very interesting is the reflective observation, to be able to reflect on what the so what of activity is. What is the learning that we know that has emerged from our own personal embeddedness of the learning experience? And that takes us to the conceptualization. So if I have this learning that applies to this one aspect, how can that knowledge be taken and transferred to other situations, other geographic locations, other organizations? And that's where we get into the active experimentation as well. Looking at the new ideas, trying to see if they work in another context. So for those of you who are very, who are well-versed in asset-based and community-driven tools, you'll note that also the Kolb's learning cycle really falls into the action research cycle, and it links back to where the individual sits within that learning. So from an educator's point of view, when you are designing learning opportunities for online spaces, whether that be maybe you're providing internal information for your organization on a shared drive, maybe you're creating content on a web space that you are providing out to the world, or maybe it's very specifically for an online course. Ask yourself, how are you differentiating the content of the materials that you are providing? So in terms of reading ability, in terms of the brief overview, the summary reports, or the very detailed reports, are you providing a level of that? Is there different choices from the materials? So for example, is there a tool that that is an image, or is there a written description along with that? do I have a choice of watching a video about the message that you are trying to say, or is it strictly text-based? If you're in a learning situation as well, you also have to think about whether you're differentiating the assessment, whether your learners are able to show in different ways their new knowledge. So in an online space, it's often easy for us to fall into the, okay, let's do a discussion forum and I will evaluate your thinking in your discussion forum. So I want you to type all of your responses. But what if you gave the people an opportunity to do a diagram or to do mapping and to do voiceover video for an explanation? So what you're doing is you're giving students the opportunity to use their strengths, to use their learning preferences to show that they have that knowledge. And also, are you considering the process through the course, regardless of how long the course is, whether it be a 2-hour workshop, whether it be a 7-week session, or a accompaniment model that moves us back and forth from the classroom to community to the classroom again? What are the things that you're doing in through that whole learning cycle that isn't always the same thing? Do you have choice? Is there a variety of tasks that have been designed for people to really engage, not just with the same people all the time as well, but with other peoples within that group? And maybe it's to engage with people in the community and to come back and report to the classroom. Now, when you think about adult learning in virtual spaces, when you think about self-concept, adult learning theory of self-concept means that those learning experiences are not 100% teacher-driven. It means that you've created a learning experience that a learner can be self-directed. They can take themselves through the learning with minimal and maximum autonomy. So that's that independence of an adult learner to be able to choose the time and the place when they're doing their reading, other than a few deadlines that need to be put in place or we'll never be able to get through the course. This is a little bit of a reiteration of what was said before, but thinking about that learning experience. As I'm designing that space, am I taking into account that there's different levels of experience in my student population, different levels of background, and different levels of ability as well? So we do have a minimum threshold of qualification for courses. But within that, you know, what is that leeway of language, of needing to know prior knowledge versus providing the knowledge that will help move people forward? We also need to think about readiness to learn. Are people ready to be in an online space? Are we developing our students' sense of autonomy and comfort in that online space as well? Most people who have not taken an online course will not do so because they don't think they can be successful online. So how are we orienting them to that online space? How are we orienting them to the actual learning as well? What is the point? Remember, we talked about adult learners being, it's very pragmatic. People want to solve problems. What is it that keeps people coming back to say, oh, you know, I'm getting something out of this. What I have is some content that learners will benefit greatly from. And for us to be very explicit in how we explain that to our learners. And that can happen in our course descriptions. It can happen in our assignment descriptions, and also in the ways that we relate to each other by drawing people's experiences into that situation where people feel like they are being heard. So the here's another version of Kolb's experiential learning cycle. So when we think about how we take learning from the concrete to the reflective to the abstract to the active, where does universal design for learning fit in? Well, universal design, it has been around since the 1970s. Universal design actually came from architecture, where architects and building planners were realizing that they needed to make a design that suited the best, the most number of individuals at a time. So for example, in universal design of a building, am I creating a ramp to the door, or am I creating a set of stairs? Well, everyone can come up the ramp. Not everyone can climb the stairs. So a universal design, we're accomplishing the exact same task, but what we're trying to do is improve who can access those materials. And from a UDL perspective, it's all about learning variability rather than a disability. From my own perspective, disability is a social context. It is, I am not disabled if I can enter your building with a ramp. If your building only has stairs, the building has created disability, not me. About UDL in terms of learning, in terms of providing content and information, what you're trying to do is improve the accessibility of our course materials, of how we explain things, how we support being able to fix that curriculum to best address the differentiated learning needs, and how do we make space learners to engage in their own strategies, for them to be the experts in their own learning. So remember, linking back to the beginning of our presentation, that the learner is always in the center. So when you think a framework, when we design learning, and this can be for a workshop, it's a course, it's a handout that your organization is passing to individuals. You think about how people will engage in the information, how that information is being represented, and in what way action and expression in that. We know that the brain has very specific functions in perception, working memory, and processing. So when you think about a universal design for learning, and if we know and we acknowledge that we all have different strengths and limitations in how we process, in the ways that we access working memory, and the way that we perceive our information, it causes us to think a little more about what we're designing. Now, this image that's on the page, if you think about the why we're learning, and there's the center of the brain, there's a circular piece where it's called the affective network, the why. And that's where we engage people. So from these images, when you think about where the green and the purple and the blue, and I'll be explaining the purple location and the blue location in a second, but when we actually do brain imaging and we asked participants to perform particular tasks, different areas of the brain actually light up. So actually knowing that when we're doing the affective network, when we're getting people to think about the why they are learning, there's a place in the brain that fires up when they're engaged. So, and if you can engage people, you can get purposeful, motivated learners. You can stimulate their interest for the learning. Now, in the idea of the front half of the brain, you've got the what of learning. That is the recognition networks. So, in the representation for resourceful, knowledgeable learners, you present information in different ways. So that is where if you're a person who provides visuals, or you're only providing words, or you're only providing words on a page versus a video. Your what of learning needs to have multiple channels, multiple ways of representing the content. So for example, in this presentation, I'm giving you a PowerPoint slide. I have words on the page. I also have images that relate to the words of the page. And I'm also explaining the images and the words. So I'm giving you three ways for you to take in that information. So that's firing up the purple spaces of your brain. And what's happening in strategic network sign, the back end of your brain, is the how of learning. That's where action and expression takes place. So that's the ultimate, where you want the goal-directed learners to fire up those blue spaces of their brain so that they can actually express what they know. I'm going to talk a little bit more in depth on the next slide on this. So when you think about the purple area of your brain, it's in the center, sorry, the green area of your brain, it's in the center. It's the multiple means of engagement. It's the way to tap into interest, to offer challenges, and to increase motivation. The purple area, the front half of the brain, it's the multiple means of representation to give learners various ways to acquire the information or knowledge. And it's also the multiple means of action and expression on the back end. You're trying to provide learners with alternatives for demonstrating what they know. And again, what I have done is given you different ways of representing information. For example, this slide that I just flipped through is the same information, shown differently, a little bit of a different description. Here's another version of the same content. So it all depends on how the learner addressed that idea. So, when you are thinking of how you're optimizing relevance, how you're optimizing value, how you're optimizing the authenticity in that learning space, think about the authentic activities. Think about how you are enabling learners to connect to their own world. I need you to also think about the tasks that get them to engage and to reflect on your learning. And the way that you do that in an online space is to think about writing in terms of journals, and that can be shared either with the world as a blog, or it can also be a video diary. Maybe it's art, maybe it's graphic design, but it's not always just, you know, pen to paper or fingers to keyboard. What you want to do as well is to make sure that your activities enable your participants to do creative problem solving. Because remember, when we think about where that brain is being active, the multiple means of action and expression, the engagement, the representation, that's actually where the rubber hits the road, is to be able to take all of that knowledge and problem solve, and specifically the real world issues rather than fictitious issues that the instructor may have designed. Maybe the issue can be pulled from the learners and you can apply the tools to that particular issue. Maybe you're creating small group conversations and you're choosing one problem. But as you know from our grouping of the people in the concentric circles, every group will have a different perspective and a different idea. So again, the idea of recruiting for interest, we're looking at that center of your brain engagement. What kind of practice opportunities are there? Is there a reward system? One of the things you may learn about in your travels through the web is about something called badging, where a lot of people may like to go through these learning workshops, a webinar, and collect badges of learning that demonstrates that they have actually participated in a webinar. of autonomy as well. Think about how people are tasked to collect information and produce the information, how they are able to use the resources that are there at their own grasp, but also how they're actually putting it together in terms of designing the learning output. Is there a way to also to invent a sequence for competing tasks? So is it always does it always have to be if A, then B, then C, then D? Is there a way to branch learning opportunities? So if you start, if we all as a group of 25 of this is our main idea, and maybe four of us splinter off to pursue a particular aspect of that main idea, and six others splinter off to pursue another opportunity. And then you come back and meet at the end and put all of those results together. So again, you're linking back into your personal experience, you're linking back into your motivation, you're providing choice, you're providing an autonomy, you're not making me splinter off down that road. I get to choose that I'm going down that road. And for example, in a learning management system, you can actually design the content to allow for that branching. So if I choose this one opportunity, I can go from there. It's kind of like the building your story, where some of the gaming models, if you choose this path, these things. Excuse me. So in terms of optimizing relevance, value, and authenticity, I've talked about this a bit in the, but what you really want to do is look specifically at content, and is it pre-designed so much, and we call that canned content, is it pre-designed so much that there's no opportunity to be flexible in terms of individual participants' cultural and social relevance, and also what diversity they have in terms of experience, in terms of ability. Maybe it's a social diversity, maybe it's a physical diversity as well. Now, one of the big things in an online space is to really minimize distractions, where there are so many bells and whistles out there in online learning. If you're choosing tools and choosing methods to engage your learners, where's that sweet spot in making sure that you're not just using the tool for a tool's sake, but it's actually providing relevance and it's providing meaning, as opposed to being what's called busy work? Of a novelty and variety of risk-taking in the learning? Is there a varied level of sensory stimulation? So for example, in an online course, is it all just reading words on a screen, or is there an opportunity to listen to an instructor's voice, to listen to perhaps somebody else explain? Maybe it's an opportunity for peers to explain something. So that's where that sensory stuff. Thinking about the color and font of what you're reading and writing on a screen. You'll notice on this slide, on this presentation, I have a very simple background. A little bit of color for interest, but I'm using a white on black. I'm using a high contrast visual image, which is easier to read for all learners. Now, Just as some of my final thoughts before I get into the question and answer period of our presentation, is just to really think about how difficult it is to maintain change. Whenever I'm working with instructors and students and faculty members, it's really true that when we're comfortable doing things a certain way, it's very easy to continue along that path. And my image caption here, there's an old man driving down an antique car on a muddy road. He's following in someone else's rut. It's very hard to climb out of that rut. But once you're out of the rut, it's to stay out. And there's actually been research on this. And given the opportunity to redesign education to meet personal needs, 9 out of 10 beginners revert to the familiar. So if you've been existing in an online space, you will tend to create what you have been exposed to before. And one of the goals that I'm trying to do is have people think differently about what they're doing in digital spaces. Are there better ways, because it's now 2018, are there better ways to address engagement, to address community, to address learning and shared collaboration than what we've done before? And that's where I'm so excited about having the opportunity to do these webinars for folks, because it's an opportunity as well for people to hear something different. And from a Coady Connect perspective, our Coady graduates are also encouraged to share their knowledge in a webinar. And I also find that, oh, I can't do a webinar. That's so hard. Nah, it's really easy once you know how. Once you climb out of the rut and you embrace the unfamiliar. So just in summary, UDL does not remove academic challenges. What it does is it removes barrier to access. And if you really think about it, what you're doing is you're just teaching, you're just practicing good teaching. And on my screen, I have a series of three images, and the title is Equality versus Equity. And in the first picture, there's three boys, and they're standing on the same boxes, and they're trying to see over a fence to look at a baseball game. The very tall guy, the same box, and then there's a guy in the middle, and he's just up to his neck, he can see over, but then there's a tiny little boy who's on the same box, but he cannot see. So in this first image, it's assumed that everyone benefits from the same supports. They all are treated equally. They all have the same box. Now the second image, the tall boy is standing, and he can see over the fence. And the boy in the middle, he's standing on one box. He's at the same height as the tall boy now. He can see under the he can see over the fence. And the third little boy, he's standing on two boxes, and he's now at the same height of the other boys. Second image, the individuals are given different supports to make it possible for them to have equal access to the game. They are being treated equitably. And that's often where we stop when we think about universal design, because what we're trying to do is make sure people are treated equitably to have the supports they need. But the thing in the third image that I have here, we have the same three boys, one very tall, one medium height, one very small. They're standing in front of the fence. There are no boxes, but now the fence is a chain link fence. They can see through the fence, as opposed to the other two images where the fence was boarded. So that's a way for us to think about how everyone can see the game without supports, without any kind of accommodations, because the cause of the inequity was addressed. The systemic barrier was removed. So that's what we're trying to do with our online spaces. We're trying to create a system where there are no barriers for learning. And even when I've been doing this presentation, going through the PowerPoint presentation, I've been telling you what's on the slides. I'm describing the images. So what that does is it actually makes me think about the learning. Nope, I lost my train of thought. I was reading a question that came through. One second, I'm going to go to my content here and see if I can share the image. Yes. Ashley showed the could you shovel the ramp, please? I will as soon as I clear the steps. Lots of kids want to go up. And then a little kid in a wheelchair says, well, if you did the ramp, we could all use it. And that's exactly the point of our presentation. And you know, from the beginning of our conversation today, it's in when we're thinking about universal design, when we build a building, are we building a ramp or are we building a set of stairs? We think about designing the learning from the very beginning. It's not sticking on, it's not we're thinking about it after the fact. It's thinking about who could possibly use our learning spaces, whether that's a physical building, whether that's a digital classroom, or whether that's electronic resources. How are we designing the situation so that the most number of people can come in? So that's all I have to say today. I also included some selected references if you're interested in the UDL campus, Universal Design for Learning. The CAST organization has been doing this since the 1970s. They're the ones that do the brain design feature. And 2 months ago, I had an opportunity to meet with the founding members of CAST while we were doing another presentation. And you know, we were talking about how things really haven't changed since the 1970s. We've known about UDL, but we're still at the point where we're still advocating for these spaces. So what our whole benefit is that we're starting to see a more concerted effort in terms of what our learners need, in terms of more concerted effort of what is needed in spaces to create more equitable, to be more socially just. So I'm going to stop talking now, and I'm going to ask our participants if they have any questions to share, any comments, or any thoughts, or any Wendy, how do I? So if you'd like to pick up your mic, or you can use the chat at the bottom of your screen, you'll notice that there's a purple triangle. If you click on it, it will expand the user tools, and you'll be able to click on the chat button. Or you can click once on your microphone to turn on and ask a question, or and click once to turn it off. So I can even ask Beverly or Ashley if they have any questions or comments. Sorry about that. So the link has appeared in the chat. And what that is for is to evaluate the webinar. It helps us with our funding, to say that we've done what we've said we'd do, but more importantly, it gives us feedback on how we can do better what it is we are doing. So if you could take about a minute and a half to fill out that online anonymous survey, and also folks who are listening to the recording, you'll be able to see that that link in our YouTube, in the information underneath the YouTube video. So folks, thank you very much for joining us, whether you've been joining us live or in a recorded session. For all of our Coady Connects webinars, you will find us on the Coady International Institute's webinar YouTube channel, and all of our webinars are there as a playlist. Our Coady Connects graduates are also encouraged to join us online in our Coady Connects Graduate Learning Network, and you can contact Coady Connects at stfx.ca if you're having difficulty logging in. Or as a graduate, you do not have a username and password, we'll be happy to provide that for you. Thank you very much, and I'm going to turn off the recording.